Good morning. We're starting off with Dr. Giuliana Muscio, who is a professor of film studies at the University of Padua. She received a PhD at UCLA and was a visiting professor at UCLA and at the American Studies program in Minneapolis. In Padua, she's the head of the International MA in Atlantic and Globalization Studies and of the Masters of Audiovisuals and Media Education. Her research deals with the relations between Italian and American cinema, Italian diaspora in the Americas, transnationalism, cosmopolitanism, Mediterranean studies, history of Italian media, screenwriting, women in silent cinema. And she's published numerous works such as Hollywood, Washington. Yeah, I'm just reading three. Lista Nera a Hollywood and Scrivere il Film. All right, welcome.
I think this conference is really groundbreaking, at least from my point of view, because it introduces a different image of Italian immigration. And much of the work I was going to do with the paper was already done by our friends yesterday. And this is what is nice about conferences, that you actually interact with other people's work. And but I have a plus that not many of you might have known. It's a documentary about San Francisco made by Frank Capra in 1926, before he started his real film career. And this documentary is about the arrival of the Incrociatore Libia, a military cruiser in San Francisco. I'm skipping all the fishermen going to the boat, the waves, and the flags, and all the, you know, sort of patriotic thing. But I think it's very important to remember that Capra, in his major career, always tried to distanciate himself from Italianness. And here we have a document that says exactly the contrary. Plus, what I think is interesting is we have been talking about Italians in California, and now you will see it, which I think is very important, because you will see how different is the image of Italy and Italians there. So the film is going, and I will be speaking on it without really referring to the images. So you have to do like when you're watching a documentary, listen and watch. This is a way to start the conversation about how different is the Italian immigration on the East Coast as on the West Coast, as we have already heard. It starts earlier than the one on the East Coast, and it's much better integrated, even if it's true that there are class differences. I like this image of the consul with the eyeglasses, a spooky guy with eyeglasses, black eyeglasses. And you can see how this is really a celebration of this moment. Italians went to California early, even during the Mexican, when California was a Mexican state. And they were very welcome, like they were in Latin America, because the same racist attitude that was going on the East was not present in California. The title of my presentation has to do with a little booklet that was published in 1891, calling California an America's Italy. And this claim, I think, is very interesting. The book was published by Harper Brothers in New York, by Charles Dudley Warner. And this is an interesting appropriation of the Italian and Mediterranean Here you can see the Bank of Italy that became later the Bank of America. an idea of the landscape, the climate, and the look of the ocean on the Pacific coast, being very Mediterranean, created a cultural expectation about this kind of association. And it's interesting that they choose, as you can see, the representation of sports in the community. They choose this representation in a way to refer back to the East, but going farther east to Europe. And as we said yesterday, this is an appropriation of the ideal pastoral past of Italy projected on California. One important element to remember is the opening of the Panama Canal, because, okay, these images already show you a different presentation. The girl in the middle, you will see soon, is Livia Maggiora, and she won a beauty contest for the Motion Picture Magazine in New York. So you see already a projection in modern media, in different things. Here you have a representation of the Italian schools in San Francisco. You will see how many people were going to the Italian school and how they are dressed up, and girls, boys, and so on at different ages. So you really have a feeling of this huge presence, which is petite bourgeois and middle class, visually, which I think is very important, because you have to chase away the images of Italians with, you know, the poor peasants, you know. They might have been peasants, but they have changed already because they made it good. What is interesting about the opening of the Panama Canal is that it opens the Pacific, it makes a connection between America and Europe with the Pacific that changes the attitude towards going to the Orient, to the East. And I think it's interesting that this happens in 1915, before the war, at least for America, and it goes into a big celebration that was done at the with the creation of the Expo. And interesting enough, the Italian pavilion at the Expo was designed by Marcello Piacentini when he was very young. You know, the most important, together with Gio Ponti, the most important, see the reference to the pastry shop, you know, from Washington Square. The idea of a gigantic crostata, I think. The idea of having the Marcello Piacentini work on the design of the exposition, is the one who designed Euro in Rome, is an interesting initiative of Ernesto Nathan, was Jewish, Freemason, and was the mayor of Rome for about 20 years, and a very important innovator. And he decided to sponsor very heavily the Pan American Exposition. So Piacentini designed this Italian pavilion using different squares and different monuments from Italy to represent this kind of. Here we have images of the North Beach area of the Italians. You can see the newspaper L'Italia that was run by Ettore Patrizzi. And there were two newspapers. And here we have the beginning of the huge banchetto, the dinner that goes on. Here is another newspaper, was more like socialist. And you know, the presence of two newspapers. This is the building of the Bank of America, of the Bank of Italy, which is impressive in itself. Amedeo Giannini created this bank to support the people after the earthquake, giving out money without interest to make things pick up very quickly and have the reconstruction. As you can see, the symbolism of, you know, fascist culture, physical education, sports are present, but not really stressed too much. And they are also American, so. And so you have the soccer game, as you could expect, and this intermingling of the sailors with the Italians in San Francisco. So let's go back to Nathan. What I think is interesting is that it took the occasion of his presence in San Francisco to elaborate a sort of presentation of the Italian community there. And Nathan wrote that a source of legitimate pride is the many children scattered abroad. This, the Panama Exposition, that won the gold medal, the Italian pavilion, and satisfying both the expectation of the American and international public and the pride of immigrants, reminding them of the land. At the exposition, they were, you know, like all world exposition, it was a consumer, Fior d'Italia was a very famous restaurant in San Francisco, and this is the banquet, and you can see how some people are really dressed up, but anyway, it's not an image of, you know, poor people having a lunch. So what was interesting during the exposition was that they had also a sort of consumerist section to it, in which they show designer Maria Monaci Gallenga, who won the first prize in fashion for the clothes she presented, with fabrics reproducing antique patterns. And at the expo in the Palace of Education and Social Economy, there was also Maria Montessori, who discussed her didactic approach so successfully that her son soon established the first Montessori school in Los Angeles. In the Palace of Fine Arts, the expo proposed 122 Italian artists with 159 works. If you ever saw the catalog of the exhibit I did, the Museo Ferragamo on Italy in Hollywood, There are pictures of some of these works, which were very relevant works by painters such as Ettore Tito and sculptures such as Vincenzo Gemito. But what is more interesting is the presentation of the Futuristi. It was the first presentation outside Europe. So another aspect of this expo was the presence of the Canessa establishment. Was like an art antique dealer, very important in Italy, good friend of Caruso, and supplying some of the furniture for the Hearst Castle in San Simeon, and working on a new image of elegant antique European style that was going to substitute the Mexican style of California. This is very important. Okay, here you have Toastmaster Ettore Patrizzi, who was a journalist, started out as a socialist, but became a fascist, and is one of the people that was relocated at the end of, at the beginning of World War I. And then we have another character. I'm going back and forth because I want to follow the images too. This is the commander. The girl next to him with blue eyes is Dorothy Valerga. And when I read Celebre Stella Cinematografica, I thought, well, who ever heard of her? Actually, she has been an important star in silent cinema. She made 91 films as Dorothy Riviere. She married an American filmmaker called Riviere. And what is even more interesting, the Valerga family was one of the big theatrical families in San Francisco. They were running the music operation in San Francisco. So I think, this again represents a different image of, Frank Capra making this documentary. These people are already into media culture, already very advanced. So I skip all the other things about the economy of California, because we have spoken enough about it yesterday. Just reminding you, another big activity was floriculture. And this, to me, was very strange. But Ernesto Nathan, in his report, made some important observations about this situation. He said the Italian community in California was composed mostly by first-generation immigrants. In 1915, in San Francisco alone, there were 35,000 Italians, mostly laborers or self-employed. And here you have what, I always argue. Unlike in New York, Nathan noted, they are not ignorant mob reduced to worse servitude by the American and Italian mafia, who, under the notorious title of bosses, recruit them as soon as they arrive, exploit them, keep them in a state of anxiety and terror, almost like the sheep under the paw of a ferocious dog. In San Francisco, they have freedom of action. They are independent men. And this image of the Italian community in San Francisco, to me, is very important because it's the feeling I always had of the diversity of the Italian community in California. And talking about the floriculture, Nathan Norton, it is very profitable, and the climate and the soil lend themselves to floriculture, and Americans don't skimp at the price for having rare flowers in profusion. They want them to adorn the house, they want them to give them away, they want to wear them in their buttonhole. Anyone invited to a meal in a private home in a week is obliged to send a bouquet of flowers to the lady in the house. It is a tax that ranges from a minimum of $3 to a maximum of $10. Who most willingly receive it is what our compatriot the florist received. Angelo Rossi, that would become the mayor of San Francisco, started out as a florist. I conclude with another important notation having to do with architecture in California. There were two styles that came from Italian art. One was the Italian art, classic, that was used in official buildings, like Stanford Library, Royce Hall at UCLA, and so on. UCLA was built by the Pozzo Company, working in construction. So, and ornated also by Italian craftsmen. And then there was the more rustic Mediterranean style that was used for private villas with patios and an integration between landscape and the house, as in Italian villas, and both in Tuscany but also in southern Italy. You can find a lot of specific references to this work on architecture. Most of the architectures of this type of buildings were actually American, but they had studied in Europe, or they were actually, they had been on the Grand Tour. So here we have this situation in which very clearly California was able to use what John Paul Russo calls the Italophilia of the American culture. The love for arts, the idea of identifying Italian culture with the arts. And not so much of the Italophobia that had to do with the emigration. And also because Italians there accomplish a lot of things. We have already heard about certain things. I just add out of my Friuli origins that the Iacuzzi brothers from Friuli built an airplane company and then made the Iacuzzi and became, a very important industrial sector. And then we have at least Tina Modotti to remember, and the theater that is what everybody knows. It's in my book, so you can read it there. But the theater in San Francisco has been very important. The Italian theater has been very important. And Tina Modotti was an actress there. And I think it gives you a sense of the difference of this kind of, she was the protagonist of her films, which never happened to the Southern Italian performers in Hollywood films. So, hooray for Italians in California.
Maybe you know the answer, maybe you don't. When I look at this image, I see people who I think are meant to look like other Hollywood stars. So like the young lady with the tendrils is like, like a Shirley Temple lookalike, right? Your Cary Grant lookalike. Is that intentional, or is that just my perception?
I think the media culture is very sophisticated in San Francisco. And I remind you that Amadeus Giannini's brother was an important personality in film business. He was financing Hollywood. You know, it's interesting that the Bank of Italy financed early Hollywood. And I think the connection between Capra, then going to Hollywood from San Francisco, and, you know, Hearst having his villa closer to San Francisco, you know, California actually moves. And, you know, something that people don't know is that actually the film industry started moving to California in the 1915, but they moved to Santa Barbara first, and only later moved to Hollywood. So there is an integration between, you know, Ferragamo was making shoes in Santa Barbara for the companies that were shooting movies there and moved with them to Los Angeles. It's a very advanced media culture.
Thank you, Giuliana, for sharing, especially these images. And as we're looking at East versus West Coast, I'm just struck by North versus South. And maybe it's just a misunderstanding of mine, but I remember that learning that most of the Italians in California and San Francisco in particular came from the north of Italy. And if you could you comment a little bit on north and south versus...
Everything is so false in this kind of historiography and so stereotyped that I get really very upset. It's not true. Fishermen were from Sicily and Liguria, and the boat people, the people working like San Pedro is connected with Ischia. Now they have a sort of friendship, official friendship, because San Pedro is mostly a community from Ischia, and people driving the boats were from Campania or from Sicily. And you know how fishing was important in California, and it was, you know, what is interesting is that there is no isolation of the southern Italians in comparison with the East Coast. They mingle with the other Italians. We have seen yesterday the Giorgio and this type of people. You know, they came from southern Italy, but they didn't do the same things the people were doing in the East. And, you know, what is interesting is that it's true that the climate made a difference. You know, people there could practice what they were doing in Italy. Instead, in New York, they had to, you know, build the subway and the skyscrapers.
Capra always refused to be counted as Italian, but he accepted to do this. Why did they ask him was one question, and do you think there is a Capra touch in these images?
I don't think so, because he didn't do the photography. And especially at the beginning, it's not so well organized. That's why I skip all the parts with the fishermen going to the boat, because it's not always the best images you could get. I think, you know, he was a poor boy trying to get work. So, you know, and given that he had already started being interested in filmmaking, they hired him. It's sort of, you know, organized. There is a shot of the beginning of them, the director of photography and him discussing before going on the boat to meet the incrociatore. So, you know, we don't really know what, but he appears there. So we know that it's true that it's Capra, but, you know, it's a documentary. And I don't see any Capra touch because the long section, and I mean, there is a sense of community, that's true. The Banchetto has this big, you know, they do trenino at the end, you know, marching around with the music. And, you know, but I don't see any Capra.
Dr. Rosemary Serra is a professor in general sociology at the university in Trieste in Italy. Her research interests include elderly population, gender, minors, and adolescents, volunteering action, community development in different territorial areas, national and international, family addictions, and in the last 10 years, she has studied different aspects of Italian-American history and culture, and in particular, identity changes of generations of Italian-Americans. Publications include subjects of Italian-Americans such as Sense of Origins, a sense of study of New York's young Italian-Americans by the State University of New York Press, and Imaginary Myths and Metaphors of the Italian Migratory Experience in the United States. All right, welcome, Dr. Serra.
My presentation is divided into two parts, and aims to analyze some aspect of the migration of Italian to California yesterday and today. So in the first part, I will consider some elements of change and continuity that have marked the generational passages of Italian immigrants, while the second part focuses on the analysis of what is left of the Italian cultural heritage among today's young generation of Italian Americans and what meaning is attributed by them to this heritage. The experience of Italian immigration on the West Coast has long been considered by most scholars in the field as unique in the panorama of Italian communities in the United States for the economic well-being and the level of integration achieved. Among those who share this interpretation is André Rol, who defined the immigrants who moved west as appraised, as opposed to the uprooted immigrants of the urban center of the East. Those who support this thesis trace the reason for this victorious adaptation to the fact that the Italian found themselves faced with a less crowded territory and with a job offer that benefited from the landscape similarity with Italy, but also to a younger and less hierarchical society where they could compete on an equal footing with the American pioneers. However, the interpretation of Italian integration that emphasizes the positive sides of the Italian experience in California tends to overlook and ignore the most problematic aspect that Italians had to face, such as poverty, discrimination, exploitation, that were present. Aspect that Italian, especially during the mass immigration period. Indeed, many Italian immigrants not only did not achieve success and fortune, but found life as difficult and unrewarded as that of other impoverished immigrants in other parts of the nation. One of the aspects that made California unique from the rest of the United States was the extremely heterogeneous demographic context since its conquest from Mexico in the war of 1846-1848. Following Thomas Almaguer, the newly established Californian state developed a racial system based on strata hierarchy in which the newly submissive native and Mexican population, Asian immigrants, those from Hispanic America and in Europe, as well as those from other areas of the country, all drawn by the start of the 1849 gold rush. The process of integration and Americanization of Italian immigrants and their positioning in this social stratification must therefore be analyzed, taking into consideration not only the acquisition of their ethnic identity, but also of a racial identity as white, in the configuration that assumed more generally in California the problem of whiteness. Studies that have examined the evolution of the idea of white race in the United States have highlighted how mass immigration from the old continent has contributed to questioning this initially monolithic concept, leaning rather to an interpretation that took into account the presence of a hierarchy of races, considering to be different in terms of physical and mental traits, and specifically of a fragmentation of the white race into a plurality of races. The placement of Italians on the color line in California is part of the white-Asian dichotomy, and it was at the origin of a way of conceiving the white race that was very different from other areas of the country. The racial pattern that had consolidated in San Francisco during the second half of the 19th century saw the white Chinese opposition, which is in the city, replaced the traditional white-black dichotomy as a greater polarization and heavier racial demarcation line. As Paris noticed, in the multiracial situation of California, where the presence of the Chinese was rooted, the acquisition of a white identity by European immigrants generally occurred quickly. California has a historical, symbolic, and cultural location for centuries. It has been considered the new frontier, the homeland of American dream, the final goal of the explorer of the West. This vision emphasized the aspect of change that underlined the migratory experience and of those who choose this life destination. It is a representation that characterized the first historians, including Oscar Endlin, who described the migratory experience as a process of uprooting and alienation. More recently, historians have emphasized the continuity between the immigrant past and their life in America. And some scholars have highlighted pattern of continuity between the lives of immigrants in the old and new world. Indeed, the experience of Italian immigrants include both important changes and great continuities, and these two poles are in a dialectic relationship. The migratory experience of Italian in California will be now, I will analyze this experience by highlighting some elements of change and continuity with respect to the society of origins. Elements of continuity could emerge from the comparison between Italy and California. In the literature, California is presented as another Italy due to the apparent similarity of climate and landscape, minimizing and overshadowing the profound social and economic differences that existed between the two countries. A new element compared to life in Italy was the residential mobility of the Italian immigrants. The study carried out by Cinelli in San Francisco highlights how the majority of Italians found themselves having to change home at some point of their life in the city. And in Italy, most people spend their entire adult life in the same house, and some spend their entire life in the same place. Furthermore, the children of immigrants who grew up in the neighborhood created by their parents decided at a certain point to abandon them. The beginning of this large-scale movement occurred in the middle of the 1930s and lasted for about three decades. However, this pattern of geographical mobility among Italians have not led to the disappearance of the old neighborhood. The closeness between generations survived, albeit in new forms. In terms of work, many elements of variation linked to the process of vertical mobility from the first to the second generation are noted. second generation Italian American had a significant degree of occupational improvement over their fathers. By the time of marriage, the children of immigrants in general had better jobs than their father at the peak of their working lives. Let's look some social aspect. Emigration was a disruptive phenomenon for family life, both for immigrants and for the family they left behind. Historians do not agree on the impact immigration had on family. Early scholars emphasize the negative aspect that separation and relocation had on family life, a view that lead back to the interpretative categories of change and disintegration. More recently, historians express a more positive view, arguing that immigration did not break up the family. This last perspective instead refers to the analytic categories of stability and continuity. It has been demonstrated that among the old immigrant national group, the first generation of Italians showed the strongest tendency toward endogamy. This predisposition to marry with one's own national group lasted for a long time, but in the 1950s, things began to change. Another element of continuity in the relationship between the first and the second generation of Italian immigrants refers to the parental control. First generation immigrants attempt to exert control over their children's lives in the same way that their parents in Italy had attempted to dominate their choices. But what worked for the first generation no longer worked for the second generation. The authoritarianism of immigrant parents belonged to a different world from the one into which their children were born. Chinelle put it in this way, quote, "The most interesting and ironic sign of continuity between the generation is the similarity in the reaction of Italian parents when their children decided to go to San Francisco and of the immigrants when their children left San Francisco." So let's go now to look at today and look what is left of this heritage to the new generation of Italian Americans. Today, Italian Americans are inserted in the middle upper range of American society, and the majority of young people between the age of 18 and 35 attend or have attended college, thus demonstrating a remarkable protagonism in the working sphere. In short, they are perfectly integrated in the American society. How then does ethnicity enter their life? Many studies dedicated to immigration and ethnic relations in the United States have highlighted how ethnic descent would not cease to be a mechanism of social reproduction. This phenomenon would mainly concern the ethno-national group that arrived in the United States at the time of the mass immigration, such as the Irish, Italians, German, Poland, and so on. Belonging to a specific immigrant group would not longer have the characterization of an ascriptive trait. That is to say, a characteristic that a person does not depend on his will or his choice. The succession of generation of immigrants highlights a weakening and loosening of the bond with the motherland. Now, the reflection that will follow are the result of research conducted in the city of New York and San Francisco, which is part of a very large study that has touched four continents and involved 14 countries where the presence of Italian is significant. So the study highlighted how Italian ethnicity has lost some external connotation, but is not a component removed from social life. However, the ways and social codes through which it manifests itself have changed. Ethnicity by descent is no longer expressed through a linear process of social and cultural identification. The affirmation of ethnic ancestry is increasingly becoming a reflective issue, and the new generation of Italian Americans are expressing form of cultural introspection through which they seek out and share form of sociability linked to the ancestry. The expression of Italian ethnicity could interpreted through a dichotomy. On the one hand, there are elements that unify those who identify with it, and on the other hand, characteristics that distinguish them from those who do not feel this belonging. From the interviews conducted on young Italian Americans, it has been noted that the existence of an immigrant imaginary where the residues of a sense of belonging are deposited, which, although it was stronger in the past, continues to persist even in the present. Through selective processes, young people of Italian origin carry within them the personal stories of their family who left Italy to reach the United States. When recalling this topic, young people appeal to a fixed narrative scheme: poverty and difficulties in the country of origin, the problem that arise when they arrived in America, and their resolution, for example, the protection found in the family or in group of compatriots. The narrative of this path is marked by common stage, and in the end, opinion converge on a positive balance. Immigration to the United States has been success. This commonality of images and memories converges in a common scheme which compose this migratory imagery, which represent a functional framework in support of an individual biography. The story that recalls the vicissitude of the immigrant become a form of collective representation which in certain sense serve to legitimate the Italian presence in America. Ethnic belonging, despite having undergone a process of weakening, continues to have a significance in the process of self-definition of young people. When young Italian Americans talk about themselves and their place in society, they often refer to elements of Italian culture. Even if apparently these are stereotypical images and geographical, climatic, gastronomic cliché, through them, the young generation of Italian Americans seem to want to affirm a continuity, at least symbolic, with Italy. There are communicative elements that unify young Italian Americans, so to speak. But beyond this aspect, the Italian origin also becomes a matter of distinction. Today, Italianness is associated with taste and direct consumptions. Therefore, by affirming it, young people carry out actions that has a double meaning. On the one hand, they promote Italianness as a whole. At the same time, however, this distinction operates at the individual level on the definition of the self. Young Italian Americans often refer to the consumption of Italian product in their daily experience, and Italian culture and tradition are represented through consumer goods. All made in Italy is loaded with meaning that go beyond the commercial quality of the product or its representativeness as status symbol. The goods express this function of displaying ethnicity and defending the true Italian culture. By choosing the Italian product, the ties with one's own cultural root are reestablished. Italian luxury, such as Ferrari, Valentino, Armani, Bulgari, represent icons of the superiority of Italian know-how and at the same time of knowing how to be Italian. They express the uniqueness, the beauty of the work of art, the craftsmanship. Young people feel and say they are representative of all this and show their ethnicity through this recognition. This same symbolic strength is found when young people proudly claim the richness of Italy's artistic landscape and natural heritage. the display of ethnicity also passes through Italian cuisine and consumption connected to it. The use of commercial side of Italianness is aimed to highlight the aspect that have greater hold on the imagination. It is a certain fact that Italian taste has become cool in recent decades and has replaced the French one. The repertoire of ethnic distinction, therefore, fulfill important expressive and strategic function. Ethnicity also marks daily life. Calling yourself Italian in America means being proud to be Italian. The culture of which young Italian Americans say they represent and to which they refer when speaking of themselves is a stratified complex of present and past of American affiliation as well as Italian derivation to which they try to assign cultural dignity. Among this social representation, Italy assumes a symbolic value. It is not present in a concrete way in the biographical horizon of Italian America because many of them never have been there in person. Okay. So the Italian reality is therefore represented through stereotypes and categorization originated from the lack of familiarity with a nation that is little known. One more aspect that is related to the, let's say, the influence, the action of individual in the daily life. So how can this heritage has been interpreted in the daily life? We can say that there are what could be called behavior niches where this sociality linked to the descent is expressed. They are events, moments separated from the rest of the everyday life that are expressed in a specific space, often the family home, and that refer to a specific code of exchange that go beyond the daily routine. They are also temporally separated moments that interrupt ordinary social time marked by work and American life and take place according to a differently perceived temporal structure. In this moment, young Italian American express a critical detachment from the American lifestyle to focuses on frenzy. They feel critical of the scarcity of relationships and sociality due to their work-addicted existence. The alternative antagonist life scheme is the Italian one, made up of gently written conviviality, community life. Young people use the social representation of Italy to criticize the American system. It alludes to an alternative life project that is expressed through private spaces separate from the frenzy of everyday life and coinciding with the form of Italian spirit. The fact that this desire is limited to some sector of everyday life, private life, however, confirms how strong the answer is to the American way of life. Thank you.
I have a question regarding something you said a little bit earlier, that there was a distinction in representation along racial lines that distinguished Italian Americans in California from New York, and you had posited that maybe had something to do with the sense of the frontier, that there was maybe sort of an equalization that occurred in the West that was not necessarily present in the East. I wondered if you could explain that a little more. But then secondly, do you feel that distinction is something that maybe, as you were talking about the Italian Americans of today, also affected representations today, that maybe Italians in the West feel differently, Italian Americans, let's say, in the West feel differently in terms of their positionality than those in the East because of these longstanding differences, or no?
Actually, my reflection comes from, as I said, a study that has been done in New York mm-hmm. and San Francisco on the young population of Italian American descent. So I think that the consideration that comes from this study can be, I mean, there's not going to be a huge difference in the young population. So it's kind of something that goes in the same direction in respect of what was in the past, maybe, you know, that there was a different situation for the Italian. As I said in the beginning, in the West and the East Coast, the position was totally different because the hierarchical strata was different there. There was much more an intermingle of population that come from different backgrounds, so they were all included in this hierarchical situation. In New York, it was different situation. New York and the East Coast was different kind of position that they had.
Hi, I also wanted to follow up a little bit on the issue of race. So you were talking about how the survey revealed that today people who identify as Italian-American talk about things like beauty culture, workmanship, richness of landscape, history, cuisine, so forth, as elements of an ethnic distinction. To what degrees can you talk about these activities without thinking about racializing them, right? So how do Italian-Americans today sort of present themselves in a racialized way after the civil rights movement, after the white ethnic revivals, in our current age of immigration restriction, as distinct and yet white, you know, having the white privileges and yet occupying this special space? And so I just wonder, you know, you talked so much about the ascription to whiteness in the earlier era, you know, how are we seeing that today? And what do those sort of markers that they're self-identifying say about them in terms of their racialization?
I don't have data that comes from research on the field, so it's something that has to be go deeper from, you know, making a specific study on what you ask for, and I think that that should be addressed more deeply to having a better view of that. But I have no data on which I can refer, so I'm not gonna go deeper on that.
I'm wondering more about this new generation of Italian Americans in San Francisco. Who are they? I'm thinking about the interviewees. The field work, if you can tell us more about that. Because when I think about California in the different generations and the peculiarities also of these different generations, one thing that I think Giuliana was mentioning was the importance also of being enemy aliens and the relocations and the interment in some cases, and the fact that that has had linguistically, for instance, over multiple generations, but I don't know how that has changed for the newer generations, because I can think of different arrivals in the 60s, 70s, and more recently with the technology sector in Silicon Valley, in San Francisco. So.
Yes, well, I didn't go through this subject of the last wave that started after the 60s that put here a new wave of Italians that came for technological reason, that went to, you know, and the Silicon Valley and all of that that happens there. So it's a different type of Italians that arrive on that on this third wave, and is still going on, because this was not included in the study that I mentioned before, but has to be, you know. It is a totally different situation for them, I think. So it doesn't go to this specific study that I mentioned before.
So what were the young Italian Americans?
I was just talking about Italian Americans. That means second generation. And I didn't talk about the third wave of Italians that went to California, starting from the 60s, so it's a different approach.
My question is more
about the language that they use when they talk to you and how they self-identify. Because in my large class about Italian Americans in film, no matter how many times I tell them that it's a class about Italian Americans, they always use the term Italian. And I'm not trying to essentialize anything. You all know me. I'm perfectly fine with the fluidity of these terms. But I'm always struck by the fact that even if I repeatedly go back to this idea that there are geographical and historical distinctions, they hold on to a very fossilized term, which is Italian, even though some of them are fourth or fifth generation. And going back to your point, I wonder whether it has a lot to do with the whiteness of it. This semester, for the first time, people thought that talking about Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing was actually racist. I mean, it was articulated as such, and this is maybe interestingly after Black Lives Matter that I guess has scared some of them, right? But I was just wondering if this has come up in your study. What term do they use to talk about themselves?
I'm referring not a direct study I did, but it's part of the study that has been done by others. So I didn't do directly the interviews with them, but the fact that they use the Italian is very common. They identify with the Italianness and Italian when they talk about themselves. So they refer as themselves as Italian. And they don't make distinction between, they don't say Italian-American, they just say Italians.
My question is very quick. Since you've been talking about this study, could you identify it?
I will give you the exact reference. It's commissioned by the General Council of Italian Abroad and by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to the Institute for Educational and Training Research.
What do Italian youth today have to identify with Italian America? It's whatever the media stereotypes are, or whatever ballroom dancing their parents do at some event that they have no interest in. So of course they're going to identify with Italy, because Italy is in their internet stream. Italian America is not in their, unless they now get involved with the Italian American podcast. So.
Very interested in this whole conversation, because as an Italian American who grew up in a very ethnic family, I've tried to, and of course this is personal, I don't think it can be assigned to a general generalization, but I've tried to preserve that culture in my family, who these kids, I mean, my children are fourth generation, third or fourth generation, and like I said yesterday, we still make the wine, we still make sausage, but that's, I did that specifically so that they would have an identity, not only as Italian, but as Italian-American. So it has, there's a family unit here that has to continue to preserve the culture. And I don't know how widespread that is, but I think there has to be a conscious effort in the family unit to continue to have these young people identify as Italian-American.